Richard Boyd-Barrett, you won't do, am I right in saying you won't do business with anybody? So a vote for you is a vote for opposition.
No, that's not true at all.
But you've said you won't do business with any of them.
No, in fact, we haven't said that at all.
Well, half of you aren't mad about Sinn Féin because you didn't sign up to Right to Change. Half of you are okay with Sinn Féin. What do you think?
Yeah, People Before Profit signed up to Right to Change and we're cooperating with the Anti-Austerity Alliance, and indeed we'll talk to anybody who's willing to pursue genuinely progressive policies based on lifting the burden of austerity and giving the proper funding to our health and education and public services.
So you would go into government
and
with Gerry
Adams? Fighting for equality. And we will discuss with anybody who's interested in those things. And that's why we've signed up to the Right to Change platform. What we will not do is do what the Labour Party did in the past, in fact on many occasions, which is swap their principles and their promises and their policies in order simply to get into power and then betray those policies. We've had enough of that.
All right. So, and now it's the turn of the nominated leader of the Anti-Austerity Alliance, People Before Profit, Richard Boyd-Barrett.
The Anti-Austerity Alliance and People Before Profit want to see a society based on real equality and solidarity, where people have the right to housing, they have the right to health, they have the right to a decent education, and where the wealth in our country is shared in a fair and progressive way. We also want to end the discriminations against women where they don't have the right to control their own bodies, and repeal the Eighth Amendment. We want to end the discrimination against young people. We want rights for our disabled citizens and minorities. And we want to leave behind the civil war politics of cronyism and broken promises and protecting golden circles and fight using people power. And that's what we're really associated with, people power, to bring about the fairness and solidarity and equality that the people of this country deserve.
Thank you. The nominated leader of the Anti-Austerity Alliance People Before Profit, Richard Boyd-Barrett. The leader of Sinn Féin, Gerry Adams. The leader of Fianna Fáil, Micheál Martin. The leader of Fine Gael, an Taoiseach Enda Kenny. The leader of the Labour Party, Tánaiste Joan Burton. The nominated leader of the Social Democrats, Stephen Donnelly. And the leader of Renew Ireland, Lucinda Creighton.
Given the amount of broken promises that governments have broken in the past, and indeed the present government, what reason have we to be hopeful that we should believe anything that's promised during this election campaign?
The middle-income earners and the lower-income earners will be paying 44% as against 52%.
All right.
And for those who earn most, they will pay most.
Okay.
So that's why we want to do this. Keep the recovery going. Invest in jobs and public services.
Richard Boyd-Barrett, Fine Gael are not the only ones offering goodies. You're offering lots of goodies as well. A super-duper health system, housing for everybody, all of these things. How can you do it? How can you overpromise, given that we've just come out of that awful period?
Well, we're definitely not overpromising. I mean, when it comes to things like housing, when this country was a lot poorer than we are today in the 50s and 60s, we were able to provide council housing for people. So I think it's perfectly possible when we're a lot wealthier today to provide at least a secure, permanent and affordable roof over people's heads. So I don't think that's overpromising. And if anything, I think it's the government at the moment who are fooling people by talking about funding these things out of a thing called fiscal space, which is really
That's banned. Yeah, that's banned from here on.
But
fiscal
it's guesswork.
Space.
It's guesswork.
But I suppose the point is, though, Richard, that if you if you say I'm going to get rid of taxes, I'm going to get rid of water charges and property tax, and yet you're promising all of this other stuff, how do you make the numbers add up without getting us back into trouble?
Well, as opposed to the government's plan to fund it out of guesswork about future growth, we're planning to finance lifting the burden of the USC, of water charges, property tax, and fund health, education, housing, and our public services by taxing the wealth and the revenue that we know actually exists. The enormous profits of the corporations who are paying a tiny amount of tax Things like the financial transaction tax, on financial speculation, okay. taxes on wealth, which okay. has grown very considerably in this country, and taxes on the higher earners. Right. Those are real identifiable sources of revenue.
We'll come back to you, Micheál Martin, and then I'll come to you, Gerry Adams, in a moment. You're...
Right. My question to the panel is, if you're in government after the next election, what initiatives would you take to promote business and employment in rural areas, and especially for young people? You know, that I was talking to Mander and Wesley McLately, and his children, maybe 16 to 21 or 2, 3 or 4 kids, he sees nothing for them in our area, nothing whatsoever. So I'm just wondering, to get the balance right between Dublin, which is moving quite well, and down the country where things are okay. really not moving at all.
All right, John, thank you very much. We'll give everyone a shot at this question, but Richard Boyd-Barrett, we might start with you on this. There's very little in your manifesto about jobs. I mean, how do you answer, John, about how you would spread jobs around the country?
I think we're in favour of directly creating jobs where the market and the private sector are not doing it, and that's particularly true, I think, in rural areas, in many small towns. A lot of the private investment tends to head to one or two hubs, Dublin and a couple of other places. What we think is we need to recruit thousands of nurses in the health service. We need thousands more teachers to deal with overcrowded classrooms. We think there's huge...
So public sector jobs. So when it comes to corporations, you want to increase the corporation tax to 15%. Is that bye-bye multinationals then as a result of that
Absolutely
policy?
Absolutely not. The first of all, what multinationals are paying in this country at the moment, the wealthiest ones, is in the region of 2%. On average, they're paying about 6%. So in the first instance, we want them to actually pay the 12.5% corporation tax rate, and that would raise about 4 billion euro. That would finance a very serious public investment programme to invest in health, education and housing, construction jobs, to build the social and affordable housing we need, more carers and home helps.
You'd want to see that, Joan Burton, surely, as well, that idea?
Is bringing them back. Good jobs, good opportunities, good country to raise their children
in. Fairness, Richard Boyd-Barrett,
you're welcome again, Gerry,
to come back to you. People are... Thank you, Gerry Adams. Gerry Adams, I was asking Richard Boyd-Barrett to respond, if you don't mind. Richard Boyd-Barrett, the Taoiseach, you've got to give it to him. The people are coming back.
Well... Look, first of all, we welcome any job, wherever it is, as long as it's properly paid. And we don't welcome these pretend jobs or exploitative jobs where people are getting a few quid on top of their dole when they should be getting paid properly in JobsBridge schemes. We think it is completely unacceptable that new entrant nurses or new entrant teachers for doing the same job are getting paid less just because they happen to be a bit younger. That is outrageous. And the fact that USI say 95% of student nurses are planning to leave the country because they think the pay is so miserable and the situation in the public health service is so awful. So if I can just... Claire made the point. Of course the private sector creates some jobs, and we welcome all of those jobs, and we certainly need to give assistance to small and medium enterprise by having a more progressive rate system which gives a break to the small enterprise and makes the big guys, the big chains, the big multinationals pay a little bit more in tax and rates so we can actually help the small business in the town centres and in the rural areas. But it is critical to say that if the public sector does not create jobs in the area of infrastructure, in the area of health, in the area of housing, in the area of education, our young people will not come back here, and we will not have the educated young people to build society.
Thank you. I really think that that's one for Joan Burton, because that Richard Boyd-Barrett, an NHS-style system, is that what you're proposing too?
Yeah, absolutely, because it's cheaper, very simply.
Yeah, but it has to work.
Of course it has to work, but it's cheaper if you don't have the private healthcare for-profit sector taking a huge amount of the expenditure that's going into health and just putting it in their back pockets. The most expenditure on health anywhere in the world is in the United States. They spend twice as much, more than twice as much as Britain does, but they have some of the worst outcomes and millions of people have no healthcare whatsoever. Britain, in a system which is free at the point of use, spend about half as much because we don't have all the money going to the private health care providers and to the private health insurance companies who are just racketeering at the moment.
I know, but you can't use the NHS system as a perfect example.
No, I'm not saying it's a perfect example. In fact, part of the problem is Margaret Thatcher tried to butcher it and introduce market mechanisms and competition, which we don't need in the health service. We don't need market mechanisms. What a health service is made up of is nurses, doctors, medicine, and the places for them to practice those things. And of course, the irony of the government talking about care in the community is precisely the story we've heard, or the one in my area where the Loughlinstown A&E was downgraded, and we said at the time to Minister Varadkar that is going to lead to a disaster in St Vincent's because the spillover will now go into Vincent's. And of course, lo and behold, within a year or two, that's exactly what happened. You close down or downgrade the local A&E services, and then you have absolute chaos in the so-called centres of excellence, which are actually a nightmare. They're understaffed. They don't have enough doctors and nurses.
And Kenny, I will come back to
the experts in this issue.
Well, I just want to make... I just want to make the point. Both Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael, between them, took 10,000 mostly frontline staff, mostly nurses, out of the health service and closed down thousands of hospital beds. You certainly don't get a better public health system by doing that. But you know the irony on the crisis in the A&E and the waiting lists is it's not as if the capacity doesn't exist in the country. Because at the same time you could be sitting in a war zone of a hospital that is overcrowded, you will hear ads on the radio, which all cuts a lot of fancy ads, saying, but if you can pay to come to the Beacon Clinic or to Blackrock, you can come in and there's no queues at all, right? And this is the problem. We have a two-tier system where healthcare is being dished out on the base of the size of your wallet, not on the basis of medical need. And that is what we need to address.
Okay, all right. To get finance to invest in housing. Finance that doesn't necessarily come from state coffers. So we're proposing to do what they do in Germany, for example, which is to take funds from private pension funds, match it with state lands, administer it through local authorities, and build an extensive, social housing a profitable enterprise for pension funds. It's a long-term investment. It will ultimately, the properties revert to the state. They stay in state ownership ultimately, but it's a long-term making money. It's about private pension funds making money from social housing. Well, it's about providing housing. And the reality is, I mean, we've had about six different announcements now from the government parties for various housing schemes. No houses have been built. We saw the most scandalous intervention by the Minister for Environment and his junior minister, who actually wrote to local authorities telling them to relax building standards, exactly what we don't need because we have to learn from the lessons of the past. What do you think about that, that private pension funds would invest in building social houses?
I don't think you will provide social and affordable housing on the basis of who can make profits out of it. In fact, the reason we had an economic crash is precisely because we turned the provision of housing into a casino and we allowed the banks and others to speculate on the area of housing rather than understanding that
Because we're not proposing that anything of the sort happens. This is how houses are built in Germany. In Germany, average house prices are 3 times average income. In Ireland, during the boom, there were 16, 17 times average income. Even today, there are 11 times average income. So our housing market is completely out of kilter, and we have to start using best practice as they apply it in other countries. This has worked elsewhere.
The main point I would make is that the provision of council housing is self-financing. Okay, it actually creates a revenue stream for the state. So whatever upfront money you have to put in, and we have it in the strategic investment funds, the credit unions have actually offered the government money to build social housing. We can borrow it from the European Investment Bank at very low interest rates. It's not a problem. The problem is the political will and the disastrous decisions that were taken by this government. In 2011, a Labour minister
sent around a circular saying we are stopping building council housing, full stop. And then Joan Burton compounded that problem in the face of warnings that it would be disastrous by reducing rent allowance, and said at the time it would drive rents down, and in fact went rents through the roof. And then they made the problem even worse by selling off all NAMA's property and land to vulture funds, who are now ratcheting up rents and making even more people homeless.
Okay, so let's...
What we need is a return to old-style council housing provision,
so you
and affordable housing and rent controls, so that these rat-renting
vulture funds... Just so we're clear, Richard, on what you're going to do.
People on the street.
Are you going to fund developers to build the social housing that we need?
No, we want local authorities and a state construction firm to build the council housing, just as was done when this country was a virtual third world country. We were at least able to put a roof over people's heads. So please don't tell me we can't do it on the 21st
century. You also want to see mortgage write-downs happen. Who pays for that?
Well, we pay for it anyway. If people are put out of their homes, then they end up in the homeless system or reliant on rent
allowance. Who decides who pays their mortgage and who doesn't?
I think what we need is an approach to insolvency, mortgage insolvency, which says in the first instance we keep families in their home. Putting them out on the street still ends up costing the state money, and people will have to be housed anyway.
Isn't there a moral hazard there, though, that you're saying... Person in number 44, you get to keep your house, you don't have to pay your mortgage.
The moral hazard is the banks that engaged in reckless lending and the bondholders in Europe who financed speculation in the housing market got bailed out by us, and the people who are homeless on the streets are paying the price for the crimes of others. And this government, and indeed the previous government, chose to protect those banks, those bondholders, the people who engaged in the reckless lending, and people in mortgage distress or homeless on the streets are the ones who paid a very bitter price.
Everyone will get a chance on this one, but Stephen Donnelly, I want to come to you. You want to see Richard Boyd Barrett, your position on crime. I'm not sure what it is, because, again, there is very little in your manifesto about crime.
Yeah, well, obviously, in terms of rural Garda stations, I think if the people in rural areas want their Garda stations restored, I'm with them in that regard.
Why is there very little in your manifesto about crime?
I'll go on to say that. The big issue for us in our area, and I think in a lot of disadvantaged areas, is the slashing of community services. So, for example, in the last week... we had a project in my area, a little small project called the Oasis Project, which was a drug and youth outreach project to young vulnerable teenagers in a disadvantaged area. The HSE have slashed that, like they have slashed many other community projects. And the parents at the protest meeting we held said, and a lot of the workers there, and this cost a tiny amount of money, right? And the parents said, some of these kids are going to be carrying guns in a year or two because we've taken their services away. And the fact of the matter is, if you butcher community and drug task force services and outreach services to young people...
That's a different thing. You're talking about the causes of crime.
You have to get... Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Because I'm interested in trying to deal with crime and trying to prevent young people from falling into crime by giving them options and alternatives.
To make. But people right
it's
now...
It's a point that hasn't been made yet.
People right now have a problem with crimes happening tonight. What do you do about it? Do you increase Garda numbers? Do you reopen the rural Garda stations? What's your position?
I just made the point that I think if the people in rural areas feel they need their stations back, they should get
what
them
if
back.
They don't? What if that doesn't work, though? What if you're doing something in order to make people feel better,
but
it doesn't work? But you're doing it because people want it. You're not doing it.
I just told you what I think we should do.
No, this is very important. No point.
It's very important.
This is taxpayers' money. You're going to spend it doing something that might not work. You're saying, well, if people want it, we'll give it to them. That's populist politics.
No, it isn't. It isn't at all. I said what I think we should do in the areas that I'm familiar with. Where local communities in rural areas have had post offices taken away from them, schools closed down, or local Garda stations taken away, and they think that that has damaged their community, they have a right to have those things back. I bow to the will of the people in those areas, but in areas that I know, what we need is to put in supports and services
and
for young people in disadvantaged areas.
You are in government. I know people in rural Ireland.